does it make a huge belching sound? Or does it absorb all the energy so that no sound escapes?
So that's an interesting question. However, we already know part of the answer to that, that unless you have really amazingly simple condition, that the black hole has to be in the center of the star, and the star was not rotating and it was flat, we know that what happens is the star will get sucked into, it'll be stretched out and sucked into an accretion disk, and the black hole, and that angular momentum that's coming in has to be ejected, and so there are relative jets that come out, and if you're getting near the maximum spin rate of the black hole, 99% of the stuff gets shot out in those jets, and only 1% gets swallowed. So it's quite amazing, and so any small irregularities that happen in the universe eventually lead to spinning up the black hole, and therefore most of these relative jets that you see ejecting most of the material back out, and that might be why black holes are a certain size in the center of galaxies, which is less than 10,000 of the mass of the galaxies and don't grow much bigger than that, but still affect how things are behaving. It's an interesting topic, but we've had a fair amount of data coming in the last couple of years that really indicate to us that very little of the matter usually gets sucked into the black hole and gets ejected.
So does that make a more interesting sound? I mean, we talk about like, okay, maybe some things are boring out there, but do these kind of stupendous events make more stupendous sounds?
Not necessarily. Not necessarily, but that's what the artist does. I mean, you wouldn't need me to do, that's what I do. I try to interpret, or the new word is reimagine, you know. It's art, and it's science. And, you know, sometimes the bigger the event, the duller, the sound is not necessarily more interesting because it's epic. That's what I found.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Great question. So the question is, one, is the data that you're using to construct these, the sounds, is that publicly available? And then two, what if you put this out so that people from different cultures, presumably different musicological backgrounds, would provide their interpretations too? Would it sound different?
And it is available. It's on my website. All the sonifications, you can look up. It's called the Mysterium. Well named, where all the mysteries are. And you could hear it, each song on my CD, which I think you're going to get one of them tonight. You'll be able to hear the, I think, Mark, we have the unaltered sonification, and also, yeah, the process sonification. So we have all of this, the source of where it came from and so forth. So that's what makes this real science. Anybody who's really interested in going deep can go to MickeyHart.net, and then there's a section there that has the cosmic information from all the work that we've done. I've broken it all down so you can separate the music if you just so desire and listen to it. Yeah, it's in little sound bites and so forth.
Well, Mickey, I guess, to me, when I think of the depictions of the universe, kind of like images that we saw, and very typically you get classical music with it. And you've interpreted it a somewhat different way. I mean, you won the first Grammy for world music, right? I mean, you've worked with people from Africa, from Asia, from all over the world in music. So could you imagine doing this in a different style?
A different spot?
A different style.
Different style. Oh, no.
What if you were a tuba?
Oh, no,
singer?
No. There's no violins up there, Richard. There are no flutes.
There's no flutes?
No, I know. I've been up there. There are no harps. No saxophones. There might be a guitar or two. But they're mostly vibration, because the strings theory is that the way, and correct me if I'm wrong, that the way they're describing the universe is giant membranes that expand and contract. That is...
So it's made for the drum.
It is a drum. The universe does react like a drum. I mean, from what I've been observing, it's just not true, Doc.
It is true that a drum is a good metaphor, but in fact, it's like the the person who has the hammer and nail is everything, and he's a drummer, percussionist. And so he's going to go with the percussion sounds.
Of course.
And I think that there are other people who have pianos will do differently. Scary, huh?
Hey, Holst didn't do so.
Yeah, he didn't do so well. So he didn't have a good sonifier.
Indeed.
Okay, we have an ethnomusicologist here in the fifth row. So how do you get what we've seen and what we've discussed and the kind of wonder and the joy of it and the intriguing nature of it? How does that get to third and fifth graders? How do we get it out beyond this room so that it can indeed inspire creativity? What's the plan?
Well, we really don't have a hard plan right yet. We just wanted to get to this place and for people to see it and to understand it and to find out your enthusiasm. And where do you guys want to, where does Lounsbury want to take it, where does the Smithsonian, where do we go next is now on our table. But I certainly think that videos, short videos, something, we made it 20 so that people don't gloss over, you know what I mean? It's a hard, complex subject. So 21 minutes is enough to be able to show in the classroom, for instance. There are so many ways of distribution now. I imagine all of the creative minds in this room here will be able to help us come up with how to distribute this to the world's students. And give the enthusiasm like we have for it and share our world with these kids because, I mean, they understand music. Everybody understands music. There's no culture on this planet that does not have its music. We're coded for music. Music is a miniature of what's happening in the cosmos. That's really what this is. It's vibratory. And it's a direct replica of what's going on in the universe. That's why music is so important. Taking it out of schools is one of the worst things I could ever imagine because music leads to good science, needs good English, it needs good everything. Without music, you're bankrupt as a society.
So planetarium shows are one way we're talking about getting it out. But with the web and with DVDs, it's possible to spread these kind of things much further. And so I had hoped that we would have, you're only seeing a fraction of the material that we put together. And, you know, you'll even, some of us notice the things because we had this part where we were tying it to people and how even in very oldest cultures, people used the rhythms of the world, and Mickey alluded to it. You know, it turns out that for the Mayans, they had a separate observatory for Venus, one for the Sun, so forth, because those would tell them when to plant the crops, when the rainy season was going to be, and so forth. They were tying their life very closely to these cosmic rhythms and world life rhythms, and you find that in many cultures. Now we have a different level of doing things, but we still are tied as humans. Rhythm is part of our life.
Who was the narrator?
Excuse me?
Who was the narrator? Oh, who was the narrator?
Dr. Hart?
yes. The evil doctor to you. Both George and I was searching for you.
Yes, sir.
Sound like Walter Cronkite.
All right. We talked a little bit about how to get the information that we've been presented today into the hearts and minds of the youth of America or the world. Is there a way to look at the music as a language, or as mathematics as a language that can be taught as a language art in schools?
Well, math is math. I mean,
I agree.
Music is math. So, I mean, if you call it, and it's a universal. All musics can't play with each other, but they all share the vibratory universe. I don't know even if that answers your question, because I didn't hear the question.
Yeah, the question is...
I answered my own question.
Can you use, as he's wont to do, can you use music as a language?
Oh, music. Oh.
As well as math.
Music is... Music is human-specific and human-defining. Can you use it as a language? It's our most emotional way of communicating, absolutely. There's no other language that can translate those kind of emotions than music. Remember, music is our talking book. Thousands of years of evolution that are in those grooves. It's not about dancing. It's about propagating. It's about a lot of things. Dancing, making babies, doing a lot of things. It's a mating ritual. It's what lets us. It makes us human. Actually, and it also was one of the energies that allowed our brain to evolve from as Homo sapiens sapiens. So, yeah, I think music is a language for sure. I think it's an essential language, and I think it's and it goes deeper than we know. We don't know what's in music now. We don't know what powers there are, and they just like Tesla. Over 100 years ago, he didn't know how to deal with electricity. It's a mystery. You can't see music. You can't feel it. I mean, you can't touch it. You can hear it. You can feel it. But it's invisible. George made the invisible visible. And that's the same thing in music. Music can describe things that are undescribable, even in words. Very powerful. So once we find out what's in music, what's the code, how do we break the code, and be able to repeat a great musical experience, then that's another mystery that we're after.
It's a great way. I'm sorry to have to end it, but I want to thank George Smoot, Mickey Hart, the really amazing.
Most of these also suggest that you see injecting most of the material back out. And that might be why black holes are a certain size in the center of galaxies, which is less than 10,000 of the mass of the galaxies and don't grow much bigger than that, but still affect how things are behaving. It's an interesting topic, but we've had a fair amount of data coming in the last couple of years that really indicate to us that very little of the matter using it.
Does it make a huge belching sound, or does it absorb all the energy so that no sound escapes?
So that's an interesting question, or we already know part of the answer to that, that unless you have really amazingly simple condition, that the black hole happened to be in the center of the star, and the star was not rotating and it was flat, we know that what happens there.
The new word is reimagine, you know. That's what it's art, and it's science. And, you know, sometimes the bigger the event, the duller the sound is not necessarily more interesting because it's epic. That's what I found.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
the septum of the black hole gets ejected.
So does that make a more interesting sound? I mean, we talk about like. Okay, maybe some things are boring out there, but do these kind of stupendous events make more stupendous sounds?
Not necessarily, but that's what the artist does. I mean, you wouldn't need me to do, that's what I do. I try to interpret oil.
The star will get sucked into, be stretched out and sucked into an accretion disk, and the black hole, and that angular momentum that's coming in has to be ejected. And so there are relatively jets that come out. And if you're getting near the maximum of the spin rate of the black hole, 99% of the stuff gets shot out in those jets and only 1% gets swallowed. So it's quite amazing. And so any small irregularities that happen in the universe eventually lead to spinning up the black hole.